Good morning. Good morning. How is the house of the Lord today?
Well.
Okay, sounds like some of you are here. How's the house of the Lord today?
Well.
Okay, we'll start with that. Welcome to Meadowbrook this morning. If you are visiting with us, if you're searching for a church home, if you've been here a long time, we're glad every one of you is here, and those who are watching online, thank you also for joining us. If you are with us for the first time and you haven't filled one out before, in the bulletin that you received, there's a connection card. You can also find that in the seat rack in front of you. If you would, fill that out and drop it in the offering box or the plates on the back table there as you leave so we can connect with you and you with us. We're going to worship God today as we do every Sunday. We'll do that as we sing to Him, as we pray to Him, as we seek His face, as we remember Him through communion that we take together as one body, and then the message from the Word of God that we'll hear this morning. So let's go to God in prayer as we begin. Father, it is a great privilege to know You, and more than that, to be known by You, to be Your children. That is what we are, and we are grateful to be in Your house. We are grateful to lift up praises, to lift up worship that belongs to You alone. Lord, in everything we do this morning and when we leave, may it be what brings honor to You and furthers Your kingdom in this world. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Worship.
Let me hear ya.
Said he's going to be going away and that they know the way. So Thomas says, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus answers him and us when he says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Let's sing praises to Jesus, who is our way.
True.
We come to prayer time this morning. I have an update on Marion, praise on Marion Murphy. She actually ate some food yesterday, so that was a positive. It's been a very up and down week for Ron and Marion. Please keep them in prayer. Also, Daryl shared a prayer request that went out earlier this week for his brother-in-law, Bob Powell, who has got a lymphoma diagnosis, but more importantly, as Daryl described it to me, a need for salvation. So be praying for Bob for both of those issues going on in his life. Let's go to God in prayer. Would you bow with me? Father in heaven, we praise your name, and we praise the name of Jesus today. when we come together in this place, and even when we are apart, we do desire to worship you with one voice and one heart, because in Christ we are one. We bow before you today with humble and thankful hearts. We thank you for the gift of salvation, of peace, of eternal life. These gifts that we could never earn, that we do not deserve. Thank you for washing away our sins through the blood of your Son. Thank you for forgiving us. Lord, as we realize the mercy you have shown us, may we be merciful to those who need mercy. Help us to live holy lives that please you, that reveal your love and your greatness to all those around us. Father, you are generous beyond measure. You are faithful, even when we are not. As we grow in our faith, as we grow in understanding who Jesus is, make us generous with the time and the resources you have provided us. Open our eyes every day to the needs around us, to the ways that we can serve you and reach people for Christ. Lord, we ask you to lift up these those who are discouraged, those who are disappointed, those who are hurting and suffering. We do pray for Marion, and we pray for Ron as they go through a very difficult time. We praise you for being near and for watching over them. We pray for Daryl's brother-in-law, Bob, that you would work on his heart, that your Spirit would touch him, and that you would work through the situation that he's now going through to reveal yourself and his need for you. And Father, we all know people who have that same need. May we be faithful to pray for them, to be there for them, to show them your love and your mercy at every opportunity. Lord, please strengthen and give courage and wisdom to our brothers and sisters, wherever they are in the world, who are proclaiming the message of Christ, no matter what it costs, as they face persecution and abandonment and isolation and imprisonment. Lord, be there in their midst, and may your message overcome. May your word go out continually into every corner of this world until everyone has heard and had the opportunity to respond to the good news of Jesus. Thank you for Jesus. We pray in his name. Amen.
Excuse me. I hope this makes sense.
Anyway,
here at Meadowbrook, we practice open communion, so if you are a believer, when communion comes, feel free to partake of it and this nourishment that it provides for our souls. Anyway, Matthew 26 through 28 says, "Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and he, after blessing it, broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' And he took the cup, and when he gave thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins.'" I want to talk about gardening today. Because I hope this makes sense. As I walked out the other day and I noticed our bearded irises were starting to poke up through the ground a little bit, and I started thinking about the communion message. And you know, it's spring's coming, it's time to work in the gardens and get the lawns right and everything. Well, a few years back, I was talking to our old pastor, a real good friend of mine, and we were talking about gardening and the significance of it and different things we had to do. And you know, when you garden and you got to get the weeds and the stuff out of the garden you don't want in there. Some of those weeds you can just pick up close to the ground, pull out root and all, and they come out, no fuss, no muss. And other times, you know, you grab a weed and you pull it out and it comes out and looks pretty good. And then there's other weeds that, man, you got to get a shovel and dig out. And you know, and then there's the ones that you think you got, but there's a little root left still in there and it keeps coming back up. Well, a few years back, we were cleaning our gardens out and getting things ready, and we had some old hedges in front of the house we had to get rid of. And most of them, man, I dig them out, and they came out pretty good. And then there's one hedge, though, and I dug and dug and cut and chopped and sawed and everything, and I couldn't get it out. Finally, we had a red station wagon, Ford station wagon, and I put a big rope around the bottom of that hedge and around the root ball as close as I could get to the ground. I tied it to the back of the station wagon and started pulling it out, and all of a sudden it felt like the rope broke, and then it sounded like it was raining, and then that root ball landed way out in front of the station wagon out in the middle of the road. And boy, I'm glad there wasn't any cars coming. But that's like, you know, we all have sin in our lives, and that's like when we pray to God to help us with our sins and ask for forgiveness, and we try and change and walk away from that sin that we have. And it's like some of those sins are like those little weeds that you can just pluck out and they disappear, and no fuss, no muss. You get them rooting all the first time and they don't come back. And then there's the ones that you think you got, but there's a little bit of root down in there, and it just won't let go, and it just keeps coming back, and you finally got to dig it out and work hard to get it out. And then there's those ones that are kind of like that hedge, where the only way you're going to get rid of them is tie a rope around them and pull them out with a Ford station wagon. And to get them out of your lives, you know, and Christ took our sins when he was nailed to the cross, and he took those sins that we had, and he weeded our garden. And because of his sacrifice, we all can get forgiveness if we believe in the blood of Christ who died upon that cross for us. So shall we pray now? Father, thank you for the time we spent together. Thank you for this coming together, and we ask your blessings now upon this communion. We ask you to open our hearts and our minds to the meaning of it and the sacrifices of our Lord. Bless us now to our bodies as we take it and we take part of it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Oh, by the way, you need to weed and feed. Here's your guide.
Morning, everybody. Did you guys enjoy your extra day this past week? It was pointed out to me that on a leap year, if you're a salaried employee, you're actually working one extra day. Did you know that? So remind your bosses of that on Monday. If they start giving you a hassle about anything, tell them you worked for free one extra day last week. Now, speaking of work, you guys obviously know this. Disclaimer, I'm not an attorney. I always thought that I would make a pretty good defense attorney, though. I think that if I would have been a bit more interested in my studies as a young man, I think it would have been a role that I could have filled pretty well. I think I could have made a pretty good living for myself. I think I could have made a pretty good living for my family as an attorney, studying case law, studying precedents, and trying to develop a case that would help the jury see things the way that I wanted to see them. I've gone as far to think about it that it's probably a very good thing that I did not become an attorney, because if I did, there might be some more bad guys running around on the street than there already are today. I think about weird things like this sometimes, and it's just a what if. Because again, I am not an attorney. What I have done, though, is I have watched my fair share of courtroom dramas on TV. So because of that expertise that I have, I feel like I can fake some level of knowledge about legal terminology. And our legal term for today that we're going to be talking about is the term racketeering. And you may be thinking, why? Why in the world will we be talking about racketeering? As normal, I promise we are going to get there. I hope my tangents have not let you down so far, but today's tangent is going to be about racketeering. Racketeering, by definition, is essentially participating in some sort of a dishonest or a fraudulent business dealing. And it's not just one time of being dishonest or being fraudulent. It's fraudulent activities over a period of time, a repeated pattern of these dishonest and fraudulent activities. In 1970, our government passed a law, something called the RICO Act. And the RICO Act was a law that was specifically aimed at targeting things like organized crime, right? Like the mafia. And this new law that was created, it would allow the government to press charges and hopefully actually make those charges stick, that they would be able to actually convict, you know, that the heads of the mafioso more effectively. Again, I'm not an attorney, so this is not legal advice. I did stay at a Holiday Inn Express once, so I mean, you can take this for whatever you feel it's worth. But essentially what was happening is the government was finding it very difficult to bring down the mob from the top. Right? They were finding it very difficult to prove that the head of the snake was directly involved in some of the most nefarious activities that the mob was involved in. So this RICO Act, essentially what it felt like is maybe this kind of a wink and a nod, a way that we can say, hey, we get it, you are a really bad guy, and we want you off of the streets. And we kind of acknowledge we really probably can't win a trial to prove that you're a murderer or a drug trafficker. But what we can show is that you have, a repeated pattern of maybe extorting local businesses or laundering money. And when we can stack all of those type of charges up against each other and we can file them under this RICO Act, it now becomes much easier for us to put you away for a very long time. Right, if you're convicted of RICO charges, you can go to jail for anywhere from 1 year all the way up to lifetime imprisonment. And it was in 1980 that the first RICO charges were brought against an accused criminal. Mob charges in New York City. And since then, RICO charges have been brought against all different kinds of accused criminals. As I look around, most of us are old enough that we remember the Enron case. Do you remember that name, Enron, where white-collar criminals bilked $2.1 billion from employees' retirement accounts? Right? That was a RICO charge that was brought against those men. If you're younger, nefarious R&B singer R. Kelly, one of the reasons he sits in jail today is because he was brought up on racketeering charges. Rudy Giuliani, who prosecuted cases under the RICO Act in the 1980s, he stands charged with RICO charges in the state of Georgia. But mobsters and rappers and street gang leaders and white-collar frauds and politicians, these racketeering charges, they're brought and they pile up against them. And again, these laws exist for specifically one reason, to try to move the bar, to try to lower the bar. And I'm not saying that that's a bad thing. They do this so that people who they see as a threat, people they see as a threat to society in some way, shape, or form, they can bring charges against them and they can make them stick. Right? I don't want dangerous people out on the street either. I'm not saying that these type of charges are some way unethical, because again, once remember, I'm not a lawyer. What I am is a preacher trying to make a point that relates to the opening sections of the fifth chapter of the Gospel of John. Because what we're going to see this morning is that for as long as there have been men in power, part of their job is to make sure that those who they deem are the most dangerous in society are dealt with. Right? So often, again, when they see someone is dangerous, or they even think that someone is going to become dangerous to society, or dangerous to the status quo, or dangerous to the existing power structure, powerful men will find a way to make it easier to have that person just go away. So again, we go to the leader of the Gambino crime family, and we say, hey, we can't prove that you ordered all of those hits. And even if I could, it would take years and years and years to collect enough evidence, to convince witnesses to flip on you, to become rats. And as I'm taking that time, all that while, you are still out there doing all of these wicked things. But what I can do again is I can bring this one grand charge of racketeering against you. I can prove that you are part of a continuing conspiracy to commit or to defraud, and then I can lock you up for just as long as I could have if I would have proved all of the other accusations. So as we begin, and as we're going to look at the fifth chapter of John today, important to remember that Jesus is already on those religious leaders' radar. He's already on the radar of the people who are in power. And where we start reading today, specifically, it's the seventh day of the week, and Jesus finds himself again back in Jerusalem. He's here for a feast. It doesn't tell us which one, says he's there for a feast. And then the scene that we're at today is there was a pool or a fountain in Jerusalem that the people, they believed, had healing powers. So at this particular pool or at this fountain, people would bring their blind, they would bring their lame, they would bring their paralyzed friends and family members. And at certain times, the waters of this pool or this fountain, it would become stirred, and it was believed that at that moment, whatever it was that was ailing you could be healed, but only if you were the very first one to get into the water. The point of today's sermon is not to convince you whether this miracle at the fountain really worked or not. But this fountain, this pool, it sets the stage for why we are here today, why we are talking about this, because Jesus comes and Jesus approaches this pool. And as he does, he sees a man who, verse 5 tells us, has been crippled for the last 38 years. This is a man who has a very old, whether it's an injury or a defect, right? This is not a fresh wound. This is not something that just happened. This is a man who everyone who crossed this pool's path would know this man, because day after day after day, he was brought here and he was left at this pool. And he came maybe hoping for healing. Maybe he came perhaps begging for change or begging for food. But just get this mental picture and think about this man that after 38 years of not being able to use his legs, there would be no doubt about the extent or the permanent status of this man's injuries or his affliction. Let's start reading at verse 6. It says, when Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been there a long time, he said to him, do you want to be healed? The sick man answered him, sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. And while I am going, another steps down before me. Jesus said to him, get up, take up your bed, and walk. And at once the man was healed, and he took up his bed and walked. Now that day was the Sabbath. So again, Jesus, when he stumbles across this man lying there, it would have been very obvious why he was laying there for the last 38 years. That the malady that was afflicting him would have had very obvious physical symptoms. But the question that Jesus asks him, he says, do you want to be healed? And the man seems to have no idea who it is that is speaking to him. Right? Perhaps he just mistakenly thinks that maybe Jesus is someone who's there to give him a hand. Right? Jesus is someone who's going to help him get up from his mat and drag him down to the water so that next time it is stirred, he's able to try to experience that miracle. But Jesus, he offers him something different. Instead of offering him assistance, instead of demanding even an answer to his question, Jesus stopped and he commands the man. He says, get up. He says, take your mat and walk. And there's something really interesting here right off the bat that we should notice. Did you notice that it required no faith of the lame man for Jesus to heal him? This is very different than what we're used to seeing. The equation is different here. Immediately I was reminded of the woman with the bleeding disorder. Right? She comes to Jesus. She seeks him out. She knows who he is, and she reaches out and touches him. And Jesus' response to her is, take heart, your faith has healed you. Very different in that case, because the woman, again, she knows who Jesus is. She comes to him believing that he has the ability and the power to heal her. There's absolutely no doubt in her mind that if she can just get close enough to him, that she is going to be healed. That woman's faith was incredibly strong. But the man we meet today, he doesn't ask Jesus for a miracle. He doesn't expect or ask Jesus for healing. Again, I don't think he even knows who Jesus is, so there's nothing for him at this moment to even put his faith into. But Jesus still moves. Jesus still tells him, get up. And when he does, his legs, they function properly. And I think this is a very important reminder for us that God's will is going to be done. That while he wants our faith, it is not required in order for him to move. It is not required for him to heal. God cannot be restrained by our own shortcomings as men. But hallelujah, a miracle has been performed. That should be the response, right? Here we are, right at this fountain, and we see that God is moving. The people would be able to see that God is good. That Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Son of God, was standing right there in front of them, that God was being faithful to his people. But we may have noticed those fateful few words at the end of verse 9. They said, now that day was the Sabbath. And it's because of those few words at the end of verse 9, it means that this great story that could be filled with so much potential in this particular moment for Jesus to finally be recognized and appreciated for who he is, it means our story is about to take a very hard left turn. This miracle, a man who had been crippled for 38 years, we would think this is something that should be universally celebrated. We should think that this is something where if the people see a broken man being restored to wholeness, is something to be celebrated. Instead, what we're going to see is that this act of mercy and this miracle, that it's about to face some pretty harsh condemnation. Both Jesus and the man are going to face condemnation from the very people who we would think would be most excited to see that God was there and moving in this way at this time. Verse 10, it says this. It says, so the Jews said to the man who had been healed, it is the Sabbath. And it's not lawful for you to take up your bed. But he answered them, the man who healed me, that man said to me, take up your bed and walk. They asked him, who is the man who said that to you? Take up your bed and walk. A question that I had to ask myself, and I hope you ask yourself as well as we read this, did Jesus know that it was the Sabbath when he healed this man? Of course. I don't believe Jesus to be one that would make absent-minded mistakes. Did the man who was healed, did he know that he had been healed on the Sabbath? Of course. I mean, there'd be no mistaking it at this time. Culturally, so much of these people's lives revolved around the observance of this Sabbath. There was no way that anyone who had been raised in this culture could plead ignorance. Also, when we see the first couple words of verse 10 where it says, so the Jews, understand we're not talking about, again, all of the people. We are talking, again, about the leaders of the Jews is the word that's used there. It's, again, these religious leaders who see this man carrying a mat or carrying a bed, think of it, and they're very quick. The first thing they say to him is to remind him that the physicality of what he's doing, that it is unlawful. They say, you cannot carry a mat today. That sounds crazy to us, doesn't it? If we're being honest. I can't wrap my minds around this, so I think we need to talk a little bit this morning on what the Sabbath is and what it was to these people. Right, the Sabbath, it should be a big deal. It's commandment number 4, remember? Keep the Sabbath holy. And I would hope that you would be hard-pressed to find anyone here today that would argue with you that God's commands that he gives are not good. Right? It is true that God commanded his people to abstain from work on the seventh day, just as God himself had done during creation, right? This was a time that was set aside for the people so that they could rest. It was a time set aside so that the people could devote their energy specifically to the Lord. Having Sabbath rest is a good thing. If we go back into Exodus, we see that the people, you know, they would go to extremes. They would not even collect food for themselves on the Sabbath. God would provide. He'd give the people a double portion on the sixth day so that they would have all that they needed to see them through the seventh. And even beyond Exodus, the Sabbath is still something that we see be affirmed over and over again. The prophet Jeremiah says this in chapter 17, verses 21 and 22. He says, "Thus says the Lord, take care for the sake of your lives and do not bear a burden on the Sabbath day or bring it in by the gates of Jerusalem. And do not carry a burden out of your house on the Sabbath or do any work, but keep the Sabbath day holy as I commanded to your fathers." So if that's the rule, if that's the expectation of the day, that this man who was healed, was he carrying something outside of his home? He was. While he was strolling around the city showing everyone the miraculous thing that happened, could he potentially have passed through some of the city gates? He could have. You see, the people were so mindful and they were so scared at this time that they would accidentally break Sabbath. They devised a list of 39 examples of work that could not be done on this particular day. And this way there would be no question. Everything should be black and white. Every good Jewish person would know these 39 rules and they would know what the Sabbath looked like. And I'm going to read for you from their writings. Remember, this is not Bible. Okay, this was the Jewish scholars of the day. This is the list that they provided to their people so that there would be no mistaking what you could or could not do. Their writing starts by saying the main classes of work are 40 save one. Why they can't just say 39, I don't know. But they say the main classes of work are 40 minus one. They say sowing, and not like a needle, sowing seed, plowing, reaping, binding sheaves, threshing, winnowing, cleansing crops, grinding, and sifting. Most of us aren't farmers, so far I think we all feel pretty safe. Kneading, like dough, baking, okay, now we're getting harder. Shearing wool, washing or beating or dyeing it, spinning, weaving, again, I think I'm safe. But then it says making two loops. I could not make two loops. I could make one, but not two. Weaving two threads, separating two threads, tying a knot or loosening a knot. So if you had your shoes on, they were on all day, I guess. Sewing two stitches, tearing in order to sew two stitches, hunting a gazelle, slaughtering or flaying or salting it, curing its skin, scraping it or cutting it up, writing two letters. And you also can't, it says erase one letter in order to write two letters. I thought that was clever, right? So if you told me I can't write two letters and I wanted to write something so you would understand it, I'd write one letter, then I'd erase it, and then the second, sort of like a game of charades, but they caught on to that. They said, no, you can't do that either. Where was I? Okay, I can't build, I can't pull down, I can't put out a fire, I can't light a fire, I can't strike anything with a hammer, I can't take something from one domain to another. And then it says, these are the main classes of work, 40 save one. So the healed man, when he is confronted, he recognizes right away that by the letter of the leader's law, he had fallen short. Right, when confronted in that moment, right, if you go back and you look at verse 11, when they confront him, his immediate response is, well, the man who healed me told me to do it. Right? He says, don't blame me. This isn't my fault that I'm breaking the rule. Blame the miracle worker. And truthfully, this story should have or could have ended right there. Because after Jesus heals this man, he slips out into the crowd. And even though he had healed this man and he had performed this miracle on the Sabbath, still at this point, the man still does not know who it is that has healed him. And the leaders of the Jews, since Jesus was already on their radar, they may have had suspicions, but they did not have evidence. So this story, it might have ended right here if Jesus had wanted this story to end right here. Because here's what it says in verses 14 through 17. It says, afterward, Jesus found him in the temple, and the him here we're talking about is the healed man, and Jesus says to him, see, you are well. Sin no more, that nothing worse may happen to you. The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had healed him. And this was why the Jews were persecuting Jesus, because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them, my Father is working until now, and I am working. So it's Jesus that goes and seeks out this man. No easy task at this time either. During a time of festival or a time of feast, there could have been thousands and thousands of people gathered in and around the temple. But Jesus makes it his business to go and seek out this man he had healed, and Jesus does what we see him always do. When he finds this man, he calls him to repentance. Jesus has dealt with his physical infirmity, and now Jesus shows care. He shows concern for his spiritual well-being as well. And what does the man do in return? Immediately, he runs to the leaders of the people, and he snitches. Verse 16 tells us why it is that the Jews decided they were going to persecute Jesus. They said because he was working on the Sabbath. Right, I think of this as, this is the RICO Act charge of the Sanhedrin, if you will. See, they had already decided that this guy was no good. They've already decided this guy is dangerous and we do not like him. They've decided we need to find a way to get this guy off of the streets. And you know, we could go and we could watch and we could study and we could investigate. We could debate and we could have trials and we could build a case. Or we can throw this blanket over him, this charge of working on the Sabbath. And that's something that we can make stick much easier. And with this charge, we can do away with our problem. The observance of the Sabbath has been a big deal for these people for thousands of years. It was affirmed by God as a good thing. The observance of the Sabbath is a scriptural thing. But what we see in this particular instance is we see two men. Now, one of those men happens to be fully God and fully man at the same time, but the other is just a broken sinner like us. And somehow, as we read this story, we can't help but to feel like that both of these men were justified in breaking this law that had existed in one form or another, essentially since the people have left Egypt. And what does this mean for us in 2024 America today? Questions maybe I hope you're asking yourself is must I keep the Sabbath holy, right? Can I start a fire on a particular day? Could I skin a gazelle if I wanted to? Am I allowed to write down three letters? Did my grandma sin all of those years when she would bake me cookies on a Sunday afternoon? Is the Sabbath even on a Sunday? I think we should at least be willing to ask ourselves these questions. If we are not willing to ask them, if we're not at least willing to try to seek out the answers to a question like that, I think we become in danger of putting the status quo above God's desire for our lives. So today we will ask the question, what is my obligation to a Sabbath? What can we learn from these rule breakers that we just read about in chapter 5? Again, the first one who's accused of breaking the rule, it's a fellow you may have heard of before. His name is Jesus. He's kind of a big deal around these parts. But did Jesus intentionally walk up to this man, again, what we would call a Saturday, and did we witness him put in some work? Jesus made a conscious decision that he was going to restore this man's strength to him on this particular day. Can the answer to our question be as simple as, well, if Jesus worked on the Sabbath, then so can I? And I would say no. And this is why. Again, we remember that Jesus is God. We remember that the Sabbath was established by God on the seventh day of creation. Right? We all know the story. God made everything, and then on the seventh day he rested, and he set an example for the people to adhere to. But I want to ask you a question that maybe you've never considered before. After that first Sabbath, did God continue to observe a Sabbath for himself? Did God need continual rest? Did one out of every 7 days, did God step away from his creation? So did 14% of the time, does God leave us on our own? Do the sun and the moon stop rising on the Sabbath? Does God stop hearing and answering prayers on the Sabbath? Does God still administer justice on the Sabbath? Of course he does. And even again, the Jewish scholars of the day would have said the same exact thing. They would have told you that, no, God cannot break the Sabbath because all of creation is his domain. Right? So we can't accuse God of carrying something outside of his domain if all of creation is his dominion. So even the people then, they believed that God himself was on the clock 7 days a week. And Jesus himself, he understands this. That's why Jesus is able to give this very purposeful response to the men who are accusing him when he says there, he says, my Father is working, so am I. What Jesus is alluding to in that breath is that he is held in the same account as God the Father. So I can't use that as my default answer. I can't just say, well, Jesus worked on the Sabbath, and I can too. Because again, we are not our own gods. And again, if we are honest, who we have more in common with in this story is the broken man who met Jesus one fateful day and his life was forever changed from that moment. But again, when I look at this man, I must admit that by the letter of the law at that time that was considered to be good and fine and acceptable, and it's been considered that for generations and generations, by the letter of the law, that man was guilty. I may not like it and I may not understand it, but by the letter of the law, he was guilty. He carried something from one place to another place. Simple, he broke the law. Right? No provision was given to him for miraculous circumstance. In the eyes of the law called wonderful, they would have told him, if you have been healed, that's wonderful. Just leave your mat where it is and then come back and pick it up the next morning and then no one's mad at you. Just come back, retrieve it later. There was only one who could allow this man not to observe the law. There was only one. It wasn't a Pharisee. It wasn't a member of the Sanhedrin or a priest. The only one who could tell this man that it was acceptable for him to do something other than what was commanded would have been the author of the law. Right? It would have been the one whose finger carved out that fourth commandment. And luckily for this man, the one who commanded him to take up his mat and go was I Am. And I believe that you and I, we find our freedom in the same vein as that crippled man who was laying next to the fountain. See, you and I, we find our rest in Christ alone. Jesus has come. Jesus has fulfilled the Sabbath command and provided us with rest that is not only for 14% of our lives, but a rest that is eternal and is everlasting. Rest that is more fulfilling than any break from eating the wheat in the field could ever be. New Testament writings, they confirm this. Paul writes to Gentile Christians in Colossians chapter 2, verses 16 and 17. Paul writes, therefore, let no one pass judgment on you in questions of food and drink, and with regard to a festival or a new moon or a Sabbath. These are a shadow of the things to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. It's a great place for a corny preacher line if you're prepared for one. I'd say something along the lines of, you see, shadows tend to melt away in the presence of the sun. S-O-N, sun. The point is this, the principle of Sabbath is still good. It is still very important for us to have a reminder to not work ourselves to death and lose sight of the kingdom of God. To have this reminder to set aside time to seek God and to seek His will on our lives. That is something that will never go out of style. But the legalistic view on the observance of the Sabbath, from the moment that you experience spiritual rebirth, you don't have an obligation to set aside a day of the week. And the reason being is now your entire life is to be set aside for the kingdom of God. The leaders of the day, who we want to maybe label as the bad guys, they didn't understand any of this. And how could they? These are things that had not been revealed to them as of yet. Right? They believed that they were out here and they were enforcing God's law, that they were imposing God's will upon the people. And maybe in some ways they were excited now because, again, they had this grand racketeering charge that they could bring against this Jesus of Nazareth. They could label him as the one who broke the Sabbath, and he commanded other people to do it as well. Next week, I hope you're going to join us again because we're going to look at the second half of this particular story. We're going to see how it is that Jesus responds directly to this flurry of questions that he is about to face from the Jews. We're going to see how he defends himself against this charge of committing what they would have called one of the greatest sins. Pray with me. Father, thank you for so much for Jesus Christ. Thank you for the freedom that he allows each and every one of us who have called upon his name. God, we are grateful that the burden has been lifted. Not lifted so that we can go and we can run and we can do as we please, Father, but we can walk through this life with confidence. We can walk through this life with rest. And I know rest is something that many of us in this room today, Father, are desperately in search of. So I pray that's what we would experience, that is what we would feel as we leave here today. The overwhelming presence of your peace, that rest would be upon our lives. And Father, we know that that does not always mean that there will not be struggles or challenges, that there will not be stresses that are going to affect us and those that we care about as we live in this broken world. But Father, true rest, true Sabbath rest comes from knowing who Jesus is and the promises that he has made to us. Promise that we do not need to fear those who can destroy the flesh, that we only fear those who can destroy the spirit. The promise of life everlasting, of a place where there are no more tears and no more pain. Father, that is our great hope. Father, help us to share this peace. Help us to share the rest that we experience in Jesus Christ with all that we meet. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Understand with us, please.
I once was lost, I walked away. The road was dark, I could not see. My hope was gone. Thank you.
As we close our worship service here today. First off, one that is not in the bulletin, our men's breakfast is taking place this Saturday morning. There is a sign-up sheet out in the foyer, maybe a little late getting up, but late is better than not getting up. So please, guys, if you are going to attend on Saturday, put your name on there, let us know if you're able to bring any food or beverages or anything like that so we can get a head count for that. There's also a ladies' breakfast coming up on the 16th as well, and once again, there is a sign-up sheet out in the foyer for that, so ladies, I would encourage you there. Church directory, we've been telling you for the last couple weeks that this would be the final week if you did want to get new pictures or just any picture at all in our church directory to do that. After service, if you head straight down the hallway, you're going to see Shallon, and she's going to make sure that your picture is taken and you look all nice and pretty so that whenever I go to look up your address, I can see your smiling face at the same time. Last announcement in here, a new one. You're going to see a line here for the Michigan Christian Convention. This is something that takes place annually on the campus of Great Lakes Christian College. Linda and I were able to attend last year, and we had a little video of the happenings of last year that I wanted to share with you guys before I officially invite you. So if we could play that. Now, the reason I wanted to show you that video is anyone who is a regular attender or member here at Meadowbrook has the opportunity to go to this conference at no cost. You simply have to sign up online indicating that you are a member of our church. We are one of the sponsors of this conference over the last 2 years. Again, it's a great opportunity to hear some communicators from all over the country. But also, it's a great opportunity for you to just meet some like-minded people from all over, not only Michigan, but we met people last year from Ohio, from Indiana, from all over. So I would encourage you to come out and join us. I mean, it's the 18th through the 20th of April. I'll even let you take me out to dinner one night if you come. That's how nice I am. But anyway, guys, we greatly appreciate you being our church family. We appreciate you being here this morning. Mike, would you close us in prayer?
Let's pray. Father, you are the King over all. You are the one who has saved us, who has poured out your grace on us. We thank you for the change that you've made in our lives as we have turned from our old ways and turned to you. Thank you for your ongoing love and forgiveness. Thank you for making it plain what you've called us to do and to be. Lord, go with us, and may your word and your love be in our hearts and on our lips. In Jesus' name, amen.